Hey there, I'm Dave Hearn, and I'm the director of Kissimmee Park Observatory. In this Star Hopping Extra, we're going to discuss astrophotography using an autoguider, the process of letting the computer perform your guide star position corrections for you. More about all this great stuff right after this. Stay tuned. Hey, hello, hi, and welcome to episode 29 of Star Hopping with Kissimmee Park Observatory. I'm Dave Hearn, and I'm totally enthused to be your host. In this series of programs, we'll show you the most beautiful sights in the night sky and explain exactly how to find them with your binoculars or your telescope. So in this extra episode of Star Hopping, we'll be discussing the process of using an autoguider to automate your astrophoto imaging. This topic is targeted pretty much toward our intermediate astrophotographers out there. We'll also be doing our first product review in this episode. We'll be unboxing and reviewing the Orion StarShoot AutoGuider. In episode 24 of Star Hopping, we discussed piggyback astrophotography. In that installment, we talked about the effort required to manually guide on a star while your camera shutter's open. This can be a tedious process, which, if not done well, can directly degrade the quality of your astrophotos. This fairly significant effort can be totally avoided with the addition of an autoguider to your imaging system. But this also introduces a computer, software, and wires to your imaging process. I'm not saying it makes things easier, but it does make the process more reliable because the computer is actually doing the guiding for you, and it's a lot better at noticing small movements of the guide star than you are. Additionally, the computer doesn't get tired in the wee hours. However, there's a significant setup time and technical understanding required to make this work well. When you're performing manual guiding, the process required you to frame the target object in your camera, then find a guide star in your guide scope. Once that was done, you could start your exposure series right away and just make manual adjustments as you saw the guide star drifting in your illuminated reticle guiding eyepiece. With the autoguider, you'll need to still do those original steps, but then you'll need to use the software to select the guide star and lock onto it. Then you'll need to set up a connection back to your telescope to let the computer change the speed of the motors to adjust the position of the star as necessary in order to keep it centered and locked. This does require a computerized telescope that has motors on both axes. So the auto-guiding process is all controlled by software running on your computer. In my case, I'm using PhD2 software, which is an open source product and is free. This widely used guiding software was originally created by Craig Stark of Stark Labs, who also produces the popular Nebulosity imaging software. Both of them are available for the Windows and macOS platforms. The auto-guiding process works like this. Once a guide star is selected, the software commands the camera to start repeatedly taking images. As the star begins to drift, the software determines how much it has moved since the last image it captured. Then it translates that movement into a specifically timed control signal to the telescope, which responds by turning on either the right ascension or declination motor. This moves the star in the opposite direction that it had drifted, and the star is now relocated to the original center point. Then the process starts all over again, and this just continues for as long as you're exposing. The guiding camera exposure length or sampling time can be adjusted by the software to allow the ability to pick up fainter guide stars. PhD2 will actually look at all the stars that show up in the guide camera image and then select the best one. So before we get into all the fun that this process entails, I'd like to show you an unboxing video that I did for the Orion StarShoot AutoGuider. This guiding camera product from Orion Telescope Center costs $279 US, and it's been extremely reliable so far during the couple months of use that I've had it. So let's check out the video. This will be an unboxing of the Orion StarShoot AutoGuider that I got in from Orion this weekend. And they give it to you here in a nice little tin, so it's nice to keep track of it and keep it safe while you're not using it. So let's get into the case. So here is the guider. It's a very nice unit. It's made out of aluminum. Looks like it's fairly nice milled aluminum there. And you basically have the ST4 connection and you have the USB connection. And turn it around and there's the actual CCD chip for the guider. And then they give you a nice little nose piece here that screws into the front. And that's how you're going to connect it to your telescope. It's threaded for filters there on the front. And then they give you a little dust cap for it. So that's the actual unit. So then getting into the actual case a little bit more. They give you a information about downloading the software. You can use, they give you basically two different versions of PhD to use, so you can download the software there. And then the instruction manual, and it's pretty good. It's pretty basic, but it's also online in electronic form, so you can get it there. And then the remainder of the box is just the USB cable that connects into the USB port right there, and then the ST4 cable, which is going to connect in there. Let's pull those out. So that's basically it. That's the Orion StarShoot AutoGuider. I'm going to be using this for the next couple weeks, see what I think of it, and then I'll give a actual review of it at that point. So anyway, that's the Orion StarShoot AutoGuider. So I mentioned the ST4 cable in the connection port. That's the connection that you make back to your telescope to allow it to respond to the AutoGuider's position correction commands. This is a standard RJ12 6-pin modular phone plug. This is an industry standard, and most computerized telescopes have one. So I've been using the Orion StarShoot AutoGuider with the PhD2 software for several weeks now, and it's been working really great. The only odd behavior I've seen is that sometimes it doesn't immediately connect with the software, but I do use a really long USB cable that goes the whole way up to the top of the telescope. That really could be the issue. It always seems to connect on the second attempt though, and stays connected through a multi-hour imaging run, so it's probably not an issue. Another interesting point to mention is that since I'm using the camera with my ETX-125 guide scope, which is a 5-inch scope with a 1900mm focal length, I don't see too many guide stars at a 2-second exposure level. I can get more stars on the screen by increasing the exposure to 5 seconds, but then I'm finding that the system just can't keep up with the adjustments at that slow correction rate. So finding brighter guide stars are a bit of a challenge for me, but I've been able to do it without too much trouble. With a shorter focal length guide scope, I'm sure more stars would be available. Orion also sells a small guide scope for the StarShoot AutoGuider that supposedly will work with main scopes up to 1500mm focal length. That wouldn't be enough for me, as the KPR reflector is 2000mm focal length, but it might work for your telescope. So here's an individual 2-minute subframe of Comet Linear that I took a couple weeks ago. As you can see, the star images are all pretty good. They're nice and round. This was taken at the KPR reflector prime focus, so any motion there shows up pretty fast. Another comment that I have about the StarShoot AutoGuider camera is that there's really no way to use it just as a regular imaging camera on macOS. Orion does say, AutoGuider is not recommended for use as a standalone imaging camera. But it sure would be nice to be able to capture that image on a repeating basis for planetary imaging and stacking, but I guess they have other cameras for that type of work. So with the addition of sophisticated software to do guiding, some great tools are available. PhD2 has this incredible guiding graph that tracks the deviations that it sees, and it also measures the corrections it makes. It has the ability to learn from the previous correction, and it tries to predict what changes are about to be required based on the correction history. You can watch the guiding graph to see how the tracking is going. It's possible to get sub-pixel tracking if everything is working well. What this means is the star will not drift even one full pixel on the guide camera. This is imaging nirvana, because guiding this close will yield pinpoint star images on the camera on the main imaging scope, which is what you want. But if any badness occurs, the graph goes completely wild. A gust of wind can send the guide star several pixels off center, and PhD2 madly tries to correct for it, and the star will oscillate back and forth around the center several times before it finally settles down. Or if a cloud happens to pass over your guide star, PhD complains about a star mass change and sets off an alarm. This usually means a lost subframe in your imaging series as the stars begin to become ovals or even lines. PhD2 can also look at the amount of decollation drift it's seeing over time and can measure the error in your polar alignment. There is a drift alignment tool that helps you correct any deck misalignment. Really great stuff. PhD2 is a fairly complex piece of software that requires a bit of a honeymoon period to get it working just right. But once you get it tuned for your telescope and guiding system, it does great. Getting there is a bit of a journey, though, and that's a trip I'm still taking. So let's review what we've learned about auto-guiders. We compared the auto-guiding process to manual guiding and decided it doesn't necessarily make the setup time effort much easier, but it does bring greater accuracy over an extended time. And once you get started with the imaging process, you can just relax and just watch it. Then we talked about the availability of the free open source software called PhD2, and then discussed the basic auto-guiding process where the software commands the camera to take an image, determines any motion of the guide star, and then automatically makes the necessary position corrections. Next was our unboxing video of the Orion StarShoot AutoGuider, and we talked about its abilities and its performance. Then we recapped some of the great tools available in PhD2, such as polar alignment diagnosis and adjustment, and then we finished up with some of the challenges that might occur while auto-guiding. We've really only scratched the surface here about the cool process of using an auto-guider to take your astrophotos. There are tons of great resources on the internet, and I'll provide some links in the show notes to allow you to get some more information. So that does it for this week's episode. You can find the show notes on our website at kpobservatory.org/SH029, where you can comment and leave any questions that you may have. Well, thanks for joining us, and I'll see you next week in our episode of Star Hopping.
I'm Cassie, and I hope you've enjoyed star hopping around the Milky Way. We'll continue to bring you these video astronomy tutorials every week on Thursday, and in their podcast format on Fridays. They'll be designed to help you find deep sky objects that are up in the sky at the time we post them on the internet. The reason we create these videos and podcasts is to help beginning amateur astronomers learn the sky and get more enjoyment out of their telescopes and astronomy in general. If you have any requests for potential targets in the night sky that you would like to see us discuss, just let us know down in the comments section below, or on our website blog. Don't miss our free field notes for this episode, basically the script of the show, with all the images and star charts we use for our star hopping activities. You can get them for free at kpobservatory.org/fieldnotes. If this is the first time you're checking out star hopping, and if you found this video useful, please consider subscribing to our channel by clicking the big yellow button, click the thumbs up on the video, and please share this tutorial out to your friends who like looking at stars. Also, as I just mentioned, please feel free to leave any question or comment below, and we'll be sure to respond quickly. Please follow KPO on Facebook, where we post all of our astronomical digital images, and keep everyone informed about upcoming astronomical events. We'd love to hear from you to discuss all this great stuff up in the sky. All the links to these places in cyberspace, including our website, kpobservatory.org, can be found below in the episode notes as well. And finally, if you feel this video provides you value, and if you'd like to see more, please consider supporting us on Patreon, where for a small amount per video, you can support our efforts, and help us make even more great astronomy tutorials, just like this one. So bye for now, and thank you for watching, and we'll see you next time on Star Hopping with Kissimmee Park Observatory.